Hello everyone. I, Dr. Pooja, and I've been taking the videos on biochemistry for the past one and a half months. So far we have discussed about different components of DNA and RNA. In my previous video, I had started with molecular biology. Now, molecular biology, as we all know, it is the biology of the biomolecules, or it is actually the study of DNA and RNA, which are also known as the nucleic acids, the acids which are present in the nucleus. Now, in my previous video, I had discussed about the chemistry of nucleic acids. What is the composition of these? And one very interesting thing about these, I told you that the bases, the nitrogenous bases present in DNA as well as in RNA, they are synthesized by two very important processes occurring in our body, de novo pathway and salvage pathway. So basically, in the previous video, I had discussed everything about DNA and RNA. Now today in this video, I will be taking up with the structure of DNA and how DNA undergoes multiplication. Because all of you know, DNA is actually the heredity material which is present on the chromosomes in our body and which is actually transmitted from one generation to another generation. So let's start up with my video. Now see what happens is, first of all, you should know that DNA is present as on the chromosomes. Chromosomes have a thread-like structure which is known as the chromoniemata on which DNA is arranged. And there is a difference between DNA of prokaryotes as well as DNA of eukaryotes. To be precise, I would say that prokaryotes have a naked DNA, or eukaryotes have a well-established DNA, means that DNA is wrapped in a well-defined nucleus. Or in other words, we can say that DNA is associated with the basic proteins, histones and non-histones. Now, these histones are of four main types: H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. So they are four and they are arranged in an octamer type of structure. H2A, B, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So DNA is just wrapped around this. Just like the symbol which is present in the NCERT books. So this type of structure is known as a nucleosome. And this is known as beads on a string appearance. Very important. So you can say that DNA of eukaryotes is arranged in the form of nucleosome or beads on a string appearance in the chromosomes. Like if this is the structure of chromosome, this is the chromoniemata and here DNA is arranged. Another histone is there, which is known as H1, which is actually known as the linker DNA, which is not a part of the. And if we talk about the regulation, histones play a very, very important role in regulating the entire process, because there is a flow of information. Whatever the sequence present in DNA that has to be transmitted to form RNA, which is further translating the information in the form of proteins. So this is how organization of DNA takes place. Then what are the different types of DNA? Now see, DNA is of A, B and Z type. But the form which is present in our body is BDNA. So what are the basic differences between these? If you see, out of these three types, ZDNA is left-handed. Otherwise, rest of them are right-handed. And the difference is in the base pairs per turn. BDNA has 10.5 base pairs per turn. ADNA has 11. ZDNA has 12. If we treat DNA with, say, different chemicals, it can be converted into this. It can be converted into a zigzag conformation or zDNA. But the most stable conformation in which DNA exists, it is bDNA. And the structure of bDNA was given by two very, very important scientists, Watson and Crick. Basically, there were three scientists, Watson, Crick, along with Wilkins. They were awarded the Nobel Prize also in 1972. Watson and Crick gave the major postulates, and Wilkins was the one who gave a X-ray crystallographic structure of DNA. So ideally, the Nobel Prize had to be shared with three of them. So what are the basic postulates of Watson and Crick model? This is the structure. This is the three-dimensional structure you can see. What are the basic postulates? First is, it is right-twisting. Just now I told you it is right-handed. It is double-stranded, very, very important. It has two strands. And these two strands are anti-parallel to one another. Means if one is running in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime, the other is running in the direction 3 prime to 5 prime. Very important. Then next, bases on the inner side are perpendicular to the axis. Uniform diameter, as you can see, 20 angstroms. Major and minor groove is there, and most important is complementary base pairing. Very, very important. Adenine always base pairs with thymine, which has a double bond. Guanine always pairs up with cytosine, which has a triple bond. The bonds between the bases are these are the hydrogen bonds. The bond between the base and the sugar is glycosidic bond, and the bond between sugar and phosphate is phosphodiester bond. So basically there are three types of bonds present in DNA: the bonds present between the bases, hydrogen bonds; the bonds present between the base and the sugar, glycosidic bond; and the bond present between the sugar and phosphate is phosphodiester bond. Very, very important. It is generally asked in the exam. And this is again a very important concept. Essential features, yeah, you can say basic postulates given by Watson and Crick. Then we come over to another very important composition of DNA, or it was actually given by Erwin Chargaff. And the composition is, number of purines is always equivalent to the number of pyrimidines. Adenine is equal to thymine, guanine is equal to cytosine, adenine plus thymine is equal to guanine plus cytosine, or adenine plus thymine over guanine plus cytosine is equivalent to 1, which is constant for a given species. And a very interesting question is generally asked in the exam: if the composition of adenine is given to you, say adenine is 20%. And say, you have to find out the concentration of guanine. If adenine is 20%, obviously the concentration of thymine will be 20, 20, 20, 40. So 100 minus 40 will be equivalent to 60. So the concentration of guanine will be 30, and the concentration of cytosine will be 30. This is a very important question, in fact, regarding the composition of the bases present in DNA. And one very important thing is, this Chargaff rule is not applicable for RNA and single-stranded DNA. Very, very important. It is applicable only for double-stranded DNA. Then next we come over to certain terms which are important. Say denaturation is there. See, denaturation means D is removal. Removal of the naturally existing state of DNA is denaturation. And how do we define it? It is a simple separation or unwinding of double-stranded DNA. Then renaturation. Renaturation means we are actually converting this denatured DNA into renatured DNA. Suppose if we increase the temperature, obviously the bonds between DNA would break. So it will be known as a denatured DNA. When we have to heal that DNA, renaturation will be done. And it is always slowly, not haphazardly. So formation of double-stranded DNA again, but slowly, is known as annealing. So denaturation, renaturation, and annealing, these are the three separate terms. Then another important term is TM. TM is actually the melting temperature of DNA, and it is defined as half of the temperature. Yet the temperature at which half of the DNA is denatured. And normally what we do is, I mentioned in my previous video also that DNA always absorbs at UV range. That is, it absorbs at 260 nanometers. And this absorption is due to the presence of the bases. Very, very important, because rest of the things are same. Phosphate is similar, sugar is similar. So DNA which is rich in GC base pairs will obviously have a higher TM by, because guanine and cytosine are linked by triple bonds. So large amount of energy will be required to break the bond between guanine and cytosine, then adenine and thymine. So DNA which has more GC base pairs will be known as a hyperchromic DNA. Whereas DNA which has more AT base pairs will be known as hypochromic DNA. So this is again very, very important. Then we come over to the basic central dogma of information, that how this division takes place. This is simple sent flow of information. DNA is converted to DNA by replication. DNA is converted to RNA by transcription. And whatever information is hidden in the form of genetic code, it is actually translated in the form of proteins, or RNA is converted into proteins. So we are going to take up today in this video replication in detail. Now, since DNA is double-stranded, the replication is semi-conservative in nature. Semi-conservative means half of the parental strand. Half of the parental strand will be conserved in the successive generations, as you can see in this picture also. This is the strand which is conserved, and this is the new strand which is synthesized. So replication of DNA is semi-conservative in nature. Then we come over to, obviously, since this is a biochemical process, it is not process without the enzymes. What are the enzymes here? What is the infrastructure required for the replication process? The most important enzyme is DNA polymerase, which leads to the polymerization of DNTPs. DNA helicase, which helps in unwinding, because if we see the structure of DNA, it is intertwined. It is like a rope. Whenever we try to twist that, either supercoiling will be there, or you can say underwinding will be there. Positive supercoiling, negative supercoiling. So there has to be a backup of enzymes which can actually, you know, help in unwinding of DNA helix to prevent DNA from denaturation. And whatever stress and strain is there in that while unwinding the helix, that has to be again relieved. Then for that stress relieving enzyme, topoisomerases is there. This topoisomerases is of two types, topoisomerases 1 and topoisomerases 2. As it is clear from the word itself, one is cutting one strand at one time, and topoisomerases 2 is cutting both the strands. But overall, if we see the function, basically they are the relieving the torsional strain which is actually caused by breaking of this. Then another important enzyme is primase or primer. See, there are two processes in our body which cannot initiate without a primer. One is glycogenesis and the other is DNA replication. DNA replication cannot start without a primer. And primer is nothing, but it is having already 30 to 40 nucleotides just to trigger, just to initiate the process of replication. Now, once the function is over, it is removed also. And then the function is taken over by DNA polymerase. And that is why this enzyme is known as DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. Because it is initiating the synthesis of RNA primer. But since we are forming DNA, so the base is DNA, that is why it is dependent on DNA. Then DNA ligase, it seals the nick. Nick is basically gadha. Nick is formed when there is a breakage of two bonds. So ligase is actually sealing it. Or DNA ligase is also known as glue of DNA, like a rubber. Like a, you can say, Fevikwik. It is joining the strands. And then SSBs are single strand stabilizing proteins. Lysing proteins. They prevent premature re-annealing of double-stranded DNA. So this is a very important slide. You should know the name of the enzymes. One thing I'm going to tell you here is, one very important enzyme which I have not mentioned here is, that is DNA gyrases. Or simple, you can say gyrases. Gyrases is the one which is actually present in prokaryotes, which is carrying out the function of topoisomerases. So these are the enzymes which are required in the process of replication. Now this is what happens is, see, DNA is like this. First of all, we have to select the origin of replication, which is also known as ORI, from where replication has to be started. Wherever this replication has to be started, it is actually searched by the DNA polymerases only, and it goes and forms a structure which is actually replication fork. And single strand binding proteins are here, which are actually helping in unwinding of the helix. Now what happens is, Watson and Crick, according to that model, DNA is antiparallel in nature. Antiparallel means, one strand is running in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime, the other would run in the direction 3 prime to 5 prime. Now, what is the tragedy? That new strand, always remember, new strand is always synthesized in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime. Okay. Now, when the new strand is being synthesized from 5 prime to 3 prime, this strand can easily synthesize the parallel strand. But what happens to this strand? What happens is, it moves against the growth of the replication fork. So one strand, which is automatically the normal one, will be known as the leading strand, and the other strand, which lags behind the process, will be known as lagging strand. And so many RNA primers are required for that. Small, 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 small. And these are also known as Okazaki fragments. Very important. Generally, students get confused in this. You just have to make tick one thing in your mind. Ek toh, it undergoes semi-conservative mode, and the strands are, they have to maintain the anti-parallel nature of DNA. So one strand will move along the growth of the replication fork, which will be obviously known as the leading strand. And the other strand has to, it lags behind the process of replication. That is why it is known as lagging strand, because it is mandatory to form a new strand in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime. And enzymes, I have told you, key single strand binding enzymes will be here, helicases, topoisomerases will help in this. And DNA polymerase is actually the major enzyme which is involved in the process. And it is clear from the word itself, polymerase, which is catalyzing the polymerization of DNA. Then what are the differences between DNA and RNA? Leading strand, it is along the growth of the replication fork. It is against the growth of the replication fork. Requires only one RNA primer, and it requires many primers. And since it lags behind the process, it is, the fragments were discovered by Sir Ritz Okazaki. That is why these fragments are known as Okazaki Freckles. Then next, DNA polymerase is the major enzyme. So what is the difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes? Now, in prokaryotes, DNA polymerase is of three types, 1, 2, and 3. Whereas in eukaryotes, it is of five subunits, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon. Every unit, every type has a different function to perform. And this is a very important comparative slide of prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA polymerase. Like prokaryotes, you can see DNA polymerase 1. The function is removal of the primer and gap filling. Function of DNA polymerase 2 in prokaryotes is proofreading and repair. Whereas beta fraction of eukaryotes helps in repair mechanism. Gamma, mitochondrial DNA synthesis, because DNA is present in mitochondria and chloroplast. And mitochondria and chloroplast are considered to be the semi-autonomous organelles. They have their own set of machinery. And mitochondrial DNA resembles the DNA of prokaryotes. Then DNA polymerase 3 in prokaryotes, synthesis of leading strand. Whereas this function is carried over in eukaryotes by epsilon unit. Delta helps in the synthesis of lagging strand. And DNA G helps in the synthesis of primase, and same is the function which is carried out by alpha fraction of eukaryotes DNA polymerase. So this is again a very, very important slide, which is actually telling us the difference between the different type of DNA polymerases in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Then next, again, a very, very important slide, comparison of DNA polymerases. Now see, जैसे normally हम क्या करते हैं, whenever we appear in an examination, when we finish our answer sheets, before submitting them to the examiner, we go through them again. That is what happens here, because DNA has to undergo synthesis of RNA. So synthesis of DNA is a very highly sophisticated process. Once the synthesis is finished, then proofreading occurs. Very important. Proofreading or editing of DNA is there. Otherwise, if there is any mismatch base pairing, then obviously DNA starting may it will undergo mutation. So different type of DNA polymerases help in the proofreading activity. So if there is any mismatch base pairing, there will be exonuclease. Exo means external, and nuclease is which is digesting the nucleic acids. So 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity is from 3 to 5 prime, and 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease is from 5 prime to 3 prime. So if you see, slide mate is very much clear that 5 prime to 3 prime nuclease activity is wholly solely a function of DNA polymerase 1. That is what I mentioned, that DNA polymerase 1 is the most important proofreading enzyme of the process. Whereas this enzyme, this activity is absent in poly 2 and poly 3. But 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity is present in all the three forms. And what are the functions? The function of DNA polymerase 1 is gap filling, proofreading and repair. DNA polymerase 2 is proofreading and repair. And DNA polymerase 3 is, it helps in processing of the leading strand as well as the lagging strand. So if we talk about the processivity wise, DNA polymerase 3 is considered to be a highly processive enzyme, in a sense that it is actually helping in the synthesis of leading and lagging strands. Then in my next video, I'm going to discuss epigenetics, which is actually the post replication modification, along with the inhibitors of DNA replication and DNA repair mechanism. So I think by the end of this video, you all have, you know, clarified your doubts regarding the structure of DNA and regarding the synthesis of DNA. What are the enzymes which are required for the synthesis of DNA? And DNA undergoes a semi-conservative mode. And In my next video, I'm going to discuss how this proofreading mechanism takes place, which is again a very, very important part. So if you want to know more, please subscribe to my channel. Again, I'm telling you, so that you can be benefited with maximum lectures from my side. Thanks a lot. Have a good day.